So in the previous class, we discussed about the process heating, refrigeration and air conditioning application of solar energy, solar thermal energy or solar thermal collectors. Today we are going to mainly focus upon the electrical power generation using solar thermal collectors. Electrical energy, of course, can be generated using the solar photovoltaic cells, which directly convert the radiation energy or photons into electrical energy. But the another route is to convert the solar energy first into heat, and generally high temperature heat or thermal energy, because the cycle that you may follow may be a Rankine cycle, or for that matter, in any heat pump where you want to convert the heat energy into mechanical energy or then electrical energy, the efficiency will be high if the source temperature is high. Okay, so you know about the Carnot cycle efficiency with for a heat engine which is working between temperature T1 and temperature T2, right? That is 1 minus T2 upon T1. So higher the temperature T1, the source temperature, higher the efficiency of the Carnot cycle, and that is applicable to any cycle, right? So higher the source temperature, higher the efficiency that you can expect. So because of that reason, most of the times the cycles that you use for electrical or mechanical power generation, where you want to convert heat energy into mechanical energy, you would like to operate it or the have the source at a high temperature so that your efficiency of conversion is high. So obviously you would like to go for concentrating type of collector. Though it was earlier mentioned that even a solar pond may be used, which may operate between 70 and 90 degrees Celsius temperature for running a Rankine cycle, but there obviously you will not use water as working fluid, but some other low temperature boiling organic fluid may be used as a refrigerant there. But then even the theoretical efficiency, the Carnot cycle efficiency of that cycle would be very low. So for higher efficiencies, the concentrating type of collectors are preferable. So you know about different concentrating type of collector, some of them which are which can be used are mentioned in this table. Some of these plants have already been tried, or they are there in operation, though it is not still a very commercial system which can prove itself to be economically feasible. But still, there are plants built with these technologies, and they are running. They are in operation. Many of them are in operation. So one of them is, of course, a parabolic trough type of collector, which are normally used in the power plant sizes ranging from 10 to 200. Concentration ratio in these collectors is generally not very high, up to 70 or 80 only. Peak solar efficiency is good, 21%, and solar electric efficiency is just 10 to 15%, right? And land use, which may be an important factor, because if like these power plants, as you might have already seen in some of the videos, or it will be shown in some pictures or videos now, you will see that it needs a very vast land. So availability of land is an issue for many of the solar power plants. So land use is an important criteria, and parabolic trough type of collector is consuming may consume around 6 to 8 meter square per megawatt hour annual power production. So this is not very low, but one of the lowest. Fresnel lens collector is shown to have the lowest value for this parameter. Fresnel lens is the next one which is shown, which is not actually as successful as a parabolic trough. You won't see many plants, particularly for power generation, being used for power generation, right? So Fresnel lens, the same capacity range and concentration ratio is starting from somewhat lower to even a higher value. But actually, I have not seen, I have rather seen the examples for process heating using the Fresnel lens type of collector, but not concentrating type of collector, particularly not of a very big size. Then peak solar efficiency is shown to be 20, and but the solar electric efficiency is shown to be 9 to 11%. So solar electric efficiency shows the final efficiency, like after the heat is converted into mechanical energy and then electrical energy. Okay, while this peak solar efficiency is conversion from solar energy input to heat. And then this power tower, or it is also called central receiver type of power plant. And the concentration ratio, actually what is shown here, seems too low to me. This is capacity 10 to 150, that's fine. Then concentration ratio is 300 to 1000, yes. So as you can see, if you want to go for very high concentration ratios, power tower is suitable. So you can operate your power plant at a very high temperature, exceeding even 500 degrees Celsius temperature. And that way, actually, it should have higher, should have higher solar electric efficiency, but actually that is not seen here. Most of these technologies are still under experimental and demonstration stage. So the parameters may not be optimum, and that's why it may give you lower efficiencies. And then land use is somewhat large for power tower. And there is one dish Stirling. So basically solar energy is collected by a parabolic dish type of collector, and at the focal area or point of this device, a Stirling engine is operated, and that produces power. But this system, is, as you can see, is generally for very small power production. But as you can see, the solar efficiency as well as the solar electric efficiency is good. Okay, and concentration ratio are shown to be high. So this is about different possibilities. These numbers are not it's not that they cannot be challenged, but only thing that I wanted to show with the help of this table is, one, different options, and two, the capacities. So dish Stirling is generally for very low capacity, while the others may be used for higher capacity plants. And power tower and parabolic trough have been more successful as compared to the Fresnel lens, particularly for power generation. Okay. Now the next figure shows you a general diagram or the scheme of power generation using a solar thermal collector. So as you can see, a solar thermal collector is shown here, can be a parabolic trough type of collector or even any other collector. And here there is a fluid which you are pumping through that collector, which is receiving heat from that collector. And because solar energy is not available 24/7, generally it's always a good idea, at least for the application of power plant, to store the heat or store the store the energy in some form. So here there is a energy storage. Now you are running another circuit and you are taking heat from this storage, and that heat is supplied to a boiler. So on the right hand side, it may be a power plant, a Rankine cycle power plant, or it can be any other engine also, but basically it converts heat into mechanical energy. So it's, in general, it's a heat engine working in a cycle, and the heat is supplied here. So it may be a boiler if it is a Rankine cycle, right? So steam is generated, and that steam goes to the turbine, and turbine converts it into mechanical energy, and then there is a condenser, and then it is pumped back into the boiler, right? But those components in this general diagram need not be shown. So basically this is a heat supply to the, even you may not even write a boiler here, because if it is a general diagram, so basically it's a source to this heat engine, and there will always be some heat which will be unutilized in any heat engine as per the second law of thermodynamics. So this is that sink. Generally the ambient is the sink, so a part of heat will be rejected. Remaining is converted into mechanical energy, which if the engine is coupled with a generator, you can generate electrical energy. Right. So what we are trying to show here is perhaps two things. One, the fluid which is passed through the collector need not be same as what you use in the second circuit or even in the heat engine, right? So you may use oil here or molten salt here, and then the storage is also necessary most of the times, or rather all the time, and then there may be another fluid which may be used for supplying heat into this heat exchanger. Basically this is a heat exchanger, right? Not necessarily a boiler, so a heat exchanger, and so another circuit is used for that purpose, and then the third circuit is that of this heat engine. And on a smaller scale, as I just mentioned, the parabolic dish Stirling system is also being tried, right? So one such video is shown here, though I'm not playing it now. I can post it on the in the post section, so you can watch that video if interested. And they are claiming 29.4% conversion efficiency, which actually was later on surpassed by Sandia National Laboratories in November 1984. Okay. So these systems are generally designed to cater to the needs of a few homes, right? A few tens or few hundred. One of the question was that what is the difference between this peak solar efficiency and solar electric efficiency? So solar efficiency is actually the efficiency of conversion of solar energy into heat, right? So you can see that that efficiency is quite low, right? So in actual working conditions, these solar collectors may not be able to give you very high efficiency, even from solar radiation to heat, right? This is not photovoltaic. Still, the efficiencies are not that high. So actually, the data may be a bit old, so it may be somewhat a higher number, but still, it is certainly a low value. Now this heat is available, and then you are operating a heat engine with the help of that, right? Which is, let's say this number is 20 and this number is 10. So in that case, 50% is the efficiency of the heat engine, right? So when you multiply 20 with 0.5, you get 10. So that is the final efficiency. Like in the denominator here, you will have the solar energy, and in the numerator, it is the electrical power produced by the generator. So it includes all efficiencies or all inefficiency, that is conversion from solar radiation to heat, and then heat to mechanical energy, and then mechanical to electrical energy. So this is the final efficiency, while this one is that of the collector, right? You can say this is the efficiency of a collector, while this is the efficiency of the system, collector as well as the let's say you are running a turbine and then a generator. So overall efficiency is the solar electric efficiency. This diagram is showing a parabolic trough type of system, collector system, which can be used for power generation. So one of the ways or possible working fluid in the collector system can be oil, right? Can be oil. So this oil is being pumped into multiple collectors, right? So they may be connected in series or in parallel. So like if you connect them parallel, then it is basically to increase the capacity. When you connect them in series, that is to increase the temperature, right? So they are connected in series and in parallel as per the requirement of temperature and capacity. This working fluid, thermic fluid, oil is being heated. Oil is used here because you don't want, if you don't want to pressurize the system. Otherwise, if you use water and want to go above 100 degrees Celsius, you have to pressurize the system, or you have to allow the water to boil. So if you don't want to the whole circuit to be pressurized, or you don't want water to boil in the collector, then you have to go for a working fluid like oil, right? So that oil is used as a working fluid, and then it is here you have an oil expansion vessel. Because of the temperature difference, the volume change will occur. So you have to allow for that expansion. You have to provide some additional space for that, so that the other component do not get distorted because of the increased volume. And then it will go to the regular heat exchangers, what you have in a power plant if you are running a Rankine cycle power plant. So there is a heat exchanger between oil and the superheated steam. Then this is the steam generator where boiling occurs and the steam is generated, and also the preheater, something similar to what you have in a conventional power plant. And then that low temperature oil is pumped back into the system. Now there would be hours or days when enough solar energy is not available, so you need to have a backup system, some kind of other fuel also, which can be a biofuel or it can even be a fossil fuel, and you heat the oil with the help of that when enough solar energy is not available. And what you see on the right hand side is the regular Rankine cycle, so that doesn't need much explanation. So the steam, superheated steam, is generated and is supplied to a high pressure turbine. If the temperature is high enough, you will have multi-stage staging in the turbine. Resume. So this scheme was being discussed, and I hope you understood this scheme now. Like condensation of water and pumped back into the boiler, etc. These are the things already known to you. And this condenser is being cooled with the help of a cooling tower. So you, I hope you understand all the components of the Rankine cycle. So this scheme is not just a hypothetical one, but such a system, the solar energy generating system, SGES, has been running in desert area of California for many decades now. Actually, it has completed more than 30 years now. And there are thousands of parabolic trough mirrors which are used, and the capacity is around 75 megawatt, the first phase. And the total collector area was more than 23 lakh meter square. And one mirror was around 14 meter. So that's talking about the trough collector reflector, 14 meter length by 6 meter width. And the concentration ratio is around 75. And synthetic oil is heated up to 400 degrees Celsius temperature. And then the rest of the things are like preheating of water, generation of steam and superheating of steam, and then a Rankine cycle is operated, right? So the scheme that was shown actually is the scheme followed in this power plant SGES in California in USA. So a photograph of that is also there here. You can see like hundreds, probably thousands of parabolic trough type of collectors used in this plant. Okay. And the phase two is starting, but it seems that that will use molten salt as working fluid, not the oil. So the molten salt seems to be the latest fluid which is used in the power, in the power plant, in these power plants as a working fluid. So another scheme of power plant, solar power plant, is a central receiver type of power plant. And here actually the concentration ratio can be higher and it can operate at a higher temperature. It can deliver temperatures exceeding 500 degrees Celsius temperature because of higher concentration ratio. So what is the scheme of this power plant? You can see it here, right? So there are thousands of such mirrors. These are flat mirrors called heliostats, and they are put up on the ground, and all of them reflect the solar radiation onto a receiver, cylindrical receiver as shown here, which is basically receiving the heat and providing it to the working fluid. And this is put on a tower, a very high tower, and the thousands of such heliostats, they track the sun and continuously reflect the radiation onto this cylindrical receiver. So this the fluid here, basically this is a heat exchanger, and fluid gets heated. So as it is shown here, the molten salt is pumped at around 290 degrees Celsius temperature and gets heated up to 565 degrees Celsius temperature, right? So it's a sensible heat. All of it is sensible heating of the molten salt. And then storage is done. Storage is necessary to operate it off sunshine hours. And then this salt, there is a heat exchanger, which is, you can call it a boiler, where there is a heat exchange between molten salt and water. So the steam is generated, and then the regular Rankine cycle, turbine, condenser, etc. are there. Turbine coupled to the generator to produce electrical power. And the cold salt is, again, there is a storage, and it's pumped into this receiver. So this is the scheme of a central receiver type of power plant, and a photograph of one such plant is shown, right? So even these plants, there are operating plants like this, particularly in south of Spain there is one such plant, and even in US also there is one such, at least one such plant. So here you can see thousands of mirrors, heliostats, right? They are not stationary. They have to track the sun and always focus the sunlight onto this receiver, right, which is at the top of a tower. And here you can see the power plant and the storage tank, etc.